Hello, everyone out there. Tony Galante coming back to you again with Prophecy in Christ. I hope you really, truly enjoy this message that I have for you. We're going to be going through Revelation chapter 13, verses 16 and 17 in particular. I want to point something out to you that I believe the Holy Spirit showed me in these verses, okay? Excuse me. But before I get started, please hit the likes button and hit the subscribe button. I'd greatly appreciate it. I want to thank all my subscribers, and I want to thank all those who view my videos as well too. But please hit the subscribe button. All right, thank you. Today I want to go over what the message I've titled today is. This it's the Antichrist government. Okay. Now, you may not think that this applies to you today, but it does ultimately apply to us today and to the future as well, too, okay? I want to show you what's really going on today in America in particular, okay, and how things are headed in that in that respect. And where is the Antichrist government? What is he trying to do, all right? What will he be trying to do? First of all, let me tell you this. If you're a Christian right now, a true born-again believer who believes that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and shed his blood for the forgiveness of your sin, you have to understand that you're going to be taken up, raptured up, before this event takes place. Afterwards, the Antichrist is going to show his face, or be apparent to the people here. Then others are going to come to know Christ, because they're not going to accept the mark of the beast, all right? Then, the 666 mark, also in Revelation chapter 13, but that's in verse 18, okay? I'm not going to get into the calculations of the mark of the beast, 666 and all that stuff, yet I have my own ideas about that too. I want to show you about the government, the form of government, and where are we headed as a nation too, if we don't watch it, okay? First of all, I want to show you that, I want to ask you a question. When you hear the words eternal city, all right, eternal city, where is the eternal city on this earth right now? Some of you are going to say Rome, Italy, right? In Rome, that's the eternal city, okay? But the real eternal city, biblically speaking, is Jerusalem, where Jesus Christ came from, all right? Where the temple was and so on and so forth. When Judaism was thriving, when the church was formed, okay, the Christian church. It's not, the eternal city is not Rome, okay? That was put together by popes and so on and so forth in the past. That is not the truth, okay? Biblically speaking, it's not the truth. And the new Jerusalem is going to be huge when Christ comes and sets up his kingdom on this earth, okay? But let me assure you this. This eternal city mentality came about from, if I could say this, a lot of people in those days, the Romans, where they were pagans and they went to sleep, per se, paganistic, and they woke up with Constantine telling them they had to believe, all right, in Christianity. So a lot of them went to bed one night pagan and woke up supposedly Christian, which is not the case either. There's a lot you need to know about Christianity. You just can't do it in one night, per se. But anyhow, I wanted to show you that the idea behind all of this, okay, and the government that's occurring and what we're doing to participate in it when we should not be, okay. When the Roman Empire fell, and it did fall, we also know through scripture there's going to be a reunification of the Roman Empire in the end times, and it's right around the corner, okay? The European Union has a lot to do with it. I personally believe the Antichrist is going to come out of possibly Luxembourg, okay? And I've put that in another video in the past as well, too. But because I heard it's a very small country in Europe. It makes a lot of profit. But at the same time, too, and it's very liberal, but at the same time, too, it is also quite corrupt in business, per se. This is what I've studied and read, okay? Now, put that aside, too, okay? The idea is this too, that the Holy Roman Empire was different than the Roman Empire. After the Roman Empire fell, the Holy Roman Empire occurred, okay? And who was the head of the Holy Roman Empire? Charlemagne. Charlemagne, they're not sure if he was from France or he's from Germany or maybe a mixture of both. Maybe his parents were, one parent was French and the other one was German. I don't know. But Charlemagne was considered the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, okay? The thing is this, too, is that the Pope actually asserted himself in the sense of making an emperor, okay? When you, in the past, back in the time of Rome, an emperor was a god, right? Now, the Pope turns around and says, well, I'll take care of the spiritual side, but he really was a separate country in a sense, too, almost in those days. But just to keep things peace, we'll make a emperor out of you, all right? So he made Charlemagne the emperor. All right, so Charlemagne was kind of in charge of this empire, per se. The Pope, on the other hand, was so-called in charge of the spiritual side of things, so-called, without even reading the scripture, per se, I'm sure, many times, right? Unfortunately. Now, I want to let you know this. I was watching a documentary, all right, and I noticed that the documentary showed us that there was a building that was built to Charlemagne, all right? And on the first level, the first, very first level, okay, were the common people, the workers, the farmers, the, you know, possibly even being bookkeepers and so on and so forth, the common, more common type people, the blue-collar workers, we call them, all right? And the poor, okay? And then the second level had the more affluent, okay? Those might have been your doctors and your lawyers and then so on and so forth, that kind of thing, right? They were the white-collar workers, per se. And then the third level was only for one person. That was for the emperor, Charlemagne, okay? And where did Charlemagne, you know, what was Charlemagne doing when they all got together in this building, so-called worshiping God? What was he doing? He was looking down at the people, and the people were looking up at him. So, in a way, they were looking at him as the leader, almost in the place of God, okay? This is an incorrect thing. This is not biblical at all to do such a thing, okay? But what I wanted to show you is, you have one level of people, the poor, and you have the blue-collar workers, and you have another level of people, which are the white-collar workers and so on and so forth, you know, doctors, dentists, attorneys, politicians, that kind of thing, all right? And then you had the, you know, the third level, which was Charlemagne himself, okay? Now, what does that have to do with today, okay? America is a country that believes in freedom, okay? We believe in liberty and freedom, okay? The problem is this. America is slowly heading towards this interruption. Most of the world is becoming socialistic, okay? And what does that mean to be socialistic? It means you have your poor, you have your affluent, and then you have a leader, okay? And there's no way that the poor can become affluent, all right? In other words, the poor will always stay poor. The affluent will always stay affluent because they'll all stick together and stay there and oppress the poor, okay? And the leader is going to stay the leader, per se, whoever that is. And this is what's going on today. We need to watch ourselves because this is not a country that was built on paganistic thought. This country was built on the Judeo-Christian principles of the scripture right here. The scripture's right here, all right? And the problem is we're pushing that away. And the other problem is this. This idea of these two thoughts, you know, keep the poor low and keep the rich high, and, you know, we'll keep the leaders the leader, is not the way the God wants it to be. He wants us to be free. He wants us to have the liberties of life, okay? But let me show you where it says this in the Bible, okay? I'm going to show you this. If you go to chapter 13, verses 16 and 17, I'm going to read them to you. And this is talking about the Antichrist, the beast, per se, okay? He says, and he causes all right, small and great. So you have two divisions, small and great, okay? And rich and poor, okay? And free men and slaves, and the slaves, okay? Now, we don't have slaves in America today, but sometimes people work like mad for their little tiny salary that they make. They don't have a living, okay? All right, but this is going to be the whole world, okay? Because there are slaves in the world that is still to this day, unfortunately. And then it goes on here and says, to be given a mark, okay? All right. On the right hand, not the left hand, the Bible specifies the right hand only, okay? Okay. And the forehead, okay? Or on their forehead, either way, okay? Okay. And he provides that no one should be able to buy or to sell, except the one who has the mark. In other words, these people on this earth are not going to be able to buy or sell even food or whatever unless they have the mark of the beast, right? So that's part of, and they're going to be forced into this to do this, right? Okay. Now the mark is either the name of the beast, okay, or the number of his name, okay? So there's got to be some kind of a connection between the name of this beast, and it's going to calculate into a number, and that number is going to be calculated as 666. We see that in verse 18 of Revelation chapter 13. But what I wanted to show you is this. Do you see where it says here, the rich and the poor, right? You see where it says the small and the great, okay? The free and the slave and so on and so forth. And then it talks about the right hand or the forehead, okay? I personally believe through scripture, okay, that the mark is going to be given on the forehead to those who are of the lesser financial class, all right? The slave, the poor, right? So on and so forth. The small, that kind of thing, all right? On the forehead, because they're going to be able to visibly see who they are. There's going to be a division there, and that division is going to separate them forever, according to the beast, you see? You see, the beast doesn't really know, and maybe will know, or does know, that there's only going to be a seven-year tribulation, but the beast is planning for thousands of years and going on, all right? He's not planning for a seven-year tribulation, okay? So, then on the other hand, too, those that get it on the hand are going to be what? Of the higher financial classes, your doctors, your lawyers, and so on and so forth, okay? And this is going to be a division now, all right? So they're not going to be able to fall, but the others on the bottom are not going to be able to rise up. And this is not what God wants, okay? He doesn't want oppression and suppression taking place on the earth. This is a real sure sign showing me that the Antichrist is going to be pushing for socialism, okay? You're going to have your rich and you're going to have your poor, and that is not right, okay? You're not going to have a chance to excel. You're not going to have a chance, or if somebody does something, bad or ridiculous financially, who do you think is going to suffer for it? The poor will, right? You've heard that kind of a story. in politics or wherever you go. It doesn't make a difference. It doesn't mean it's just politics. It could be in business too, you know. Sometimes people have, you know, the president and vice presidents and so on and so forth have large corporations. They goof up, and guess who gets paid less? The poor, you know, the people are making less. And this is not right. This is not what Christ wants. He wants you and I to know that we are all worth a great deal. And we have, first of all, I'm not saying that the mark is okay to have. Absolutely not. But he's giving us, Christ is giving us an indicator that there's, he wants to bless us continuously, but he wants to bless us and do it the right way. Wisdom has its perfect work. Sometimes people set goals before they have money, for instance, and then all of a sudden, whammo, the money's not there because plans didn't work out for it. And they're startled. That kind of stuff goes on a lot, okay? So I just wanted to show you this. I really believe that the Antichrist is going to be driven to socialism. I mean, communism is right there now. You've heard of horrors of communism. And, you know, with China and so, and Russia and so on and so forth. You know, we've been fighting that for a long time. But, you know, you have a lot of unhealthy people when there's socialism going on too. All right? Because the upper echelon dominates the lower. And you know what? The lower financial so-called classes should have a chance to rise and grow and get stronger. And actually, a lot of them have participated in life and given us great, you know, great inventions and so on and so forth. You know, they've given us a lot of great things. So this is what I'm trying to show you here, that, you know, people think that they're way up here, and they're not way up here to God, okay? And people think that they're way low, and they're not way low. You and I are perfect the way we are, okay? And don't let anybody ever put that in your head that you're not enough, or you need to do more, or you need to give more, or you need to not, whatever it is. That's craziness. That is not from God, okay? You listen to your heart first. Listen to the Lord in your heart first. That's what I meant. And you keep going for the Lord, okay? And stick with the Word of God, all right? Stick with the Word of God, and you will never fail in the sense of, how could I say it to you? In the sense of, I mean, we all fail from time to time, but you will never fail because the Word of God is always there. God is always there protecting you and watching over you no matter what. You can make mistakes and God still protects you sometimes, you know? But when you do something really in a great error, what else can he say? He's going to tell you, I gave you commandments not to do such things. What can I say, you know? So there are consequences to sin. But sometimes people make errors and mistakes, and God still provides a way to overcome those situations in life, okay? Sometimes people are born into a family where the family's not prosperous and they've prospered in life. And then everybody sees that, gets jealous, and they don't want that to happen to that person. Yeah, I've seen that too, okay? And so on, all right? But anyhow, that's the message I have for you today. And like I said, we have to fight the preparation of the Antichrist today because the preparation is heading towards socialism. We don't want socialism in this world. And if America falls, socialism's going to gobble up more, okay? We don't know when the Lord's going to come. He can come very, very soon, and I believe he's going to come really soon. But he could still tarry because I don't set dates. But I believe in my other videos, I said things like, he's giving us a season of possibility of when he's going to come, all right? If you go to Matthew 24, all right? All right, Lord bless you. Again, hit the likes button, subscribe, and Lord bless you all, and share my videos with other people too, okay? Because let's get the Word of God out, because I stick to the Word of God. I don't sit here and just vacillate all over the place, okay? All right, Lord bless you all, and keep your chin up. I'll be coming out with another video soon, okay? Bye-bye now. Lord bless you.